The code we'll need is on my GitHub page. I've called this Media Center. That was the first one I made. So I'm just going to go here. We'll open that up. And I'm just going to go to copy raw contents there. So let's copy that into the clipboard. And let's go to ESP Home and make a new device. Continue there. So I'm going to start this one with fan, because I like to keep all my fans together. And I'm going to call this one WLED House Front. Okay, we'll next that. Don't care about any of that. And we'll skip that. So there's our WLED house front. We're going to edit, and then I'm going to go Control A, Control V, and that will paste in my code. And then we'll go up to the top, and then we'll take that name there. We'll copy that. We'll replace the name here. And then finally, I'm going to rename this. So I'm just going to call this one house front. Next thing we need to do is we need to read the data sensor. Now I've got this turned off, so we need to turn that back on. And I'm just going to do Control question mark. That'll comment that out, and then we'll just go install. We'll do a manual download because this is the first one. We'll do legacy format, let it do its thing. All right, that's done. So we'll put that on the desktop so I can find it easy enough. We'll just save that there. We'll minimize that, refresh to find a COM port, COM port 3, which that is sitting on. And we're just going to browse to the desktop, pick up our bin file and flash. That's done. Let's go back to ESP Home and we'll have a look at the logs for this device. So we'll close that down, close that down. We'll go back to house front, open up logs. And here we can see the data sensor. So I'm going to select all of that by double clicking it. Do Control C. We'll go to edit. We'll go down to the sensor. And you see we put your address here. So we're just going to double click that again and Control V. So that's the data sensor done. And then we can comment this back out. We don't really need to see that all the time. And we'll install it. Obviously that won't take as long because all the components are built now. It's just updating that particular sensor. So we'll just wait for the logs to come back up. That's connected. So we're going to stop that. We're going to close that. And as you can see, we've got a notification now. New devices have been discovered. We'll check it out. There's our LED house front. Configure, submit, and then let's have a look at the entities that are coming in. So if we go to devices, scroll down to the fan section, and we can see house front there. Click on that. So we've got temperature coming in. We've got the alarm sense coming in, and we'll talk about that in a second. We've got the set temperature slider. Once it's set, after about a minute, this will save to flash. So I'll remember this between boots. And as you can see, I dropped that to 26. Temperature is 27, so you can see the fans come on. And we also see that the fan speed is currently its low set and it's on 3. As always, I'm using substitutions in my ESP Home code. The first one being house front. This is the name that's used for the location and the entity names. As you can see, we can use capitals and spaces. The only other thing in substitutions is maximum temperature. This is used for the maximum temperature threshold above which the fan will be at 100%. And is also used by the alarm function. Scrolling down, we can see the number. This is the slider that comes into Home Assistant. And this is the temperature threshold on how the fan speed is governed by the internal temperature. So line by line, we give it a name. And I've called this set temp for set temperature. Next, we have the actual name of the entity that comes into Home Assistant. We're using the substitution name here, which is house front. So this gets called house front set temperature. Optimistic true means that every time you move the slider, the value here gets updated immediately. Now I set 15 and 60 as the slider range, but you can change this if necessary. And I've set an initial temperature of 35. These are all in centigrade. Regardless of the initial value, once you've set the slider, about every minute, ESP Home will save that value to memory. And the last line here will recall that value and set the slider to where it was. And this way, the value is restored on reboot and power cycle. Next up is the sensor platform. This is where we initially save the address of your data sensor. The next line is the name. Again, we're using the substitution and I've just put temperature there. Give it an ID, temp sensor, and an accuracy as 0. And all that's doing is making sure that we're getting whole numbers. So we're not getting like 25 point something. Then we have the automation itself. Now I'm using the on value, which checks the data sensor's value. This is where all the automation happens. So we'll come back to that in a second. Scrolling down, we have the switch component. This is basically controlling the onboard MOSFET for the old style fans. I've given it an ID of fan power so I can reference this elsewhere in the code. You'll notice that I haven't given it a name. Without a name, a component won't add itself to Home Assistant. And there's no need to have this in Home Assistant. This is internal and part of the automation. Next up is the fan component. Now I'm using the speed fan here from ESP Home. I've given it a name of the fan. The next line is output. That's down here in the output settings. And we basically have one for the fan and one for the light. And we'll get to the light in a second. This does have a name, and because I'm using substitutions, this comes in as house front space fan, which again you've seen in Home Assistant. The fan component has two parts to it. There's a switch for on and off, but there's also a slider. Now this slider by default is always going to be 0 to 100. The step count is the number of divisions from that 0 to 100. So I've given this a step count of 100, which means that there's 100 divisions. However, if you was to set it to something like 4 will give you 0, 25, 50, 75, 100, and so on. So giving it a value of 100 will give you a more granular speed control of the fan. Another thing on this fan component, you can see we've got two automations. We've got an on turn on and an on turn off. And these are called whenever the fan component is told to turn on or turn off. And I'm using this to control the MOSFET, the fan power MOSFET. For old style fans, the MOSFET needs to be powered on when you want the fan to run, otherwise the fan will just keep on going. So I've put in this MOSFET and this control to make sure that when the code tells the fan to go off, it turns the MOSFET off as well. Scrolling down, we get to the binary sensor. I'm using this as a kind of a switch, basically, that I can turn on and off elsewhere in the code. So I've given this an ID of alarm. You'll see that in a second when I go to the automation. This does need a coming time assistant, so we can use it. Obviously, this has a name. Again, we're using the substitutions, and I just called this alarm. I've also given it an icon of fire. Next up is the light component, and this is for the control of the D1 Mini's onboard blue LED. Once again, we give it an ID so I can control it elsewhere in the code. Again, no name for this one. I don't need the light coming into Home Assistant. It's all on board and it's all controlled internally. We give it an output. That's this one down here. That just tells the code what pin it's connected to. On the D1 Mini, that's connected to D4. Finally, we have effects. Now I'm using the pulse effects, and I've given it a name of flash fast, and that basically flashes the light quite quickly. One other thing on the output for the fan PWM, as I put here, nocturne fans won't start until the PWM signal is at 10%. So I've put in a minimum power here of 0.1. However, if you're using the old style fans, then set this to 0. And then frequency here, 22.5 kilohertz, ensures that the pulse frequency of the fan coils is higher than most people can hear. Otherwise, setting this too low, if you set this to like 1 kilohertz, say, the fan will be pulsed 1,000 times a second, and you can normally hear that. This just prevents fan noise. Okay, so automation. So this is all done in the sensor component, and I'm using the on value automation. And what this does is every time the sensor is updated, all this code gets run. And then under the on value, we've got a dash here and a dash here. Now this designates a list in the automation. So this automation will do essentially two things. So the first one is controlling the speed of the fan. So what I've done here, I've made a lambda for this part, and this enables me to write some fairly complicated but fairly simple code. So the first thing I'm going to do is declare a variable, and I've called this one PTC, as this is going to be the percentage that the fan is running. Next up, we're doing a map function, and the map function will take a range of numbers and remap them to another range of numbers. X is the internal variable for this particular sensor. Next, we're looking at the state of the set temp. Remember, set temp is what I called the number component, which is the slider that comes in Type Assistant. So the range we're looking at is the state of the slider to the max temp. And again, max temp is what we set here, one of the substitutions. So every time the sensor gets updated, the value from the slider and the value from max temp gets mapped from 1 to 100. So basically what this is doing is looking at the range from the slider value to the max temp, which gets remapped to a value of 1 to 100. And then that value is put into this variable, and it's that variable we'll test on in the next line to see if it's above 1. So if the percent variable is above 1, do this, else do that. So the first line here, we're doing a call function, and what we're going to call, not Ghostbusters, and what we're going to call is the fan. Remember, the fan is the fan down here. So we're going to say the fan turn on, and that will turn the fan on. Then we're going to call the set speed function, and this is going to set the speed to the variable PCT, which comes in here. And then finally, we need to do another call, and this time to perform the action. So that turns the fan on if the percentage is above 1. If it's not, then we're going to do another call. Again, we're going to call the fan, and this time turn it off, and then execute that command with another call perform. The next part of the automation, or the second part of the automation, is the alarm function. And as I've said here, the alarm will activate if the current temperature is over the max temp, for more than 10 seconds. So we start with a condition for 10 seconds. So this condition has to be true for 10 seconds. If it is true, do another condition, and this is the actual condition that we want to check on, which is here. Again, we're looking at the temperature sensor, which is the DALIS sensor. If the state of that is more than the max temperature, which is our substitution here, then again, this is a list. We've got a little dash there and a little dash there. First thing we're going to do is turn on the D1 Mini's light with the effect of fast flash. Again, if that's true, we're going to do a second command, and this will turn on the alarm, which is our binary sensor alarm, And because it's a binary sensor, we have to do a publish state. And what that's going to do is turn the binary sensor on. If none of that is true, so if the temperature is less than max temperature, it's not a then, it's an else. We're going to do, again, two things. We're going to make sure the light is off, and we're going to turn off the binary sensor alarm with a state publish of false. And that's it. As with most of my code, you don't need to worry about any of this. You just need to set up the device name, data sensor address, and if you want to, set your slider range. Everything else is done for you. Right, that's all ready. We can unplug this now. I've got 12 volts coming in from my bench power supply, so we're going to connect that up. And let's connect the fan back to the control panel. Looks a bit messy there, so I'm going to move this to the side just so we can see it a little bit better there. Finally, the alarm setting. As I mentioned, the alarm will go off if the temperature goes above the maximum set temperature for longer than 10 seconds. So to facilitate that, I've made the maximum temperature 30 degrees for this demo. So we go back to here, we've got the set temperature set to 29. So at the moment the fan's off, if I warm this up, and hopefully we'll get it above 30 degrees, the fan's going to ramp up a lot quicker now because the maximum temperature is set. That's gone above 30 degrees, and after 10 seconds, we'll see that the alarm has come on, and you can just about see it here. The LED is flashing on the board. Okay, join me in part 3, where we'll take all these controls and put them on one single button. So if we click it, we get the set temperature, which is this slider here. Everything else is hidden. We've got the temperature coming in. We've got the fan speed, which is currently at 100% because that's the last setting it was on. So if we start this up again, and remember we've got the alarm setting at 30 odd degrees. So we see the fans come on at 100%, and then for longer than 10 seconds, where we had a binary sensor here that goes on and off, we now have a flashing button. Well, I hope this video was helpful with your projects. Please do share it so others can find it as well. I upload videos whenever I can, so subscribe and hit the bell icon to get notified. That's it. Thanks for watching.
Okay.